Hello friends, good morning to all of you. In this lecture session, we'll discuss in detail about carbohydrate metabolism, their very important concept, that is gluconeogenesis. Gluconeogenesis means biosynthesis of glucose inside our body. We don't want to biosynthesize glucose from glucose, so that's the reason why here we make use of non-carbohydrate resources for the biosynthesis of glucose, a very essential biochemical pathway in our body. So let's go ahead and then see what exactly is gluconeogenesis and its significance. Just before going into the actual topic, one fact that we need to thoroughly understand, so that is our brain needs continuous supply of glucose. Okay, so here it's not just brain, but many tissues in our body where glucose storage is not possible. Storage is not possible in many of the tissues in our body, except liver and skeletal muscle. Okay, in these two tissues, we can find glucose being stored as glycogen, and those glycogen reserves help in maintenance of blood glucose level. In the initial chapters, we discussed the need for maintenance of blood glucose level. Why do we need to maintain blood glucose level? Because many tissues in our body, like brain and kidney cells, and then epithelial capillary tissue, and then cornea. So these are some of the examples where the cells take up glucose by almost like a diffusion kind of transmission. Otherwise, here we can see GLUT1, GLUT2 type of transportation happens. Means as and when we have glucose in blood, it will be taken up into cell. Okay, it is like this. So that's the reason why we always need to maintain blood glucose level in the range 80 to 120 milligram per deciliter, so that the tissues can function. Because we don't eat continuously. Okay, we give breaks in the morning. Let's say in our daily routine, we take breakfast in the morning, and then lunch in the afternoon, and then dinner in the evening. A minimum of 5 to 6 hours break will be there between meal to meal. In that period, how actually our body can survive? Okay, the two resources that we have in the maintenance of blood glucose level, we have glycogen is one of the mechanism via which it can supply glucose. The second mechanism is gluconeogenesis. Okay, gluconeogenesis can also supply glucose, because glycogen reserves are limited. So that's the reason why gluconeogenesis also helps in the maintenance of blood glucose level. Okay, I hope you understood the concept of gluconeogenesis. Now, approximately 120 grams of the daily carb requirement, okay, out of 160 grams, because we need 160 grams of carbohydrates daily for our survival. In that, 120 grams of glucose is actually utilized by brain. That's so huge. Okay, amount of glucose present in the body fluids is about 20 grams in 6 liters of blood, because we usually contain, let's say, 80 to 120 milligram per deciliter. Deciliter means 10 ml. So if you do the math, it will come up to close to 20 grams. Okay, and then in glycogen, we'll have 600 grams of glycogen. But readily usable is approximately 190 to 200 grams only. So that's why this can immediately compensate for 1 day 1 to 2 days, okay, 1 to 2 days for our survival. Because this is not enough, this is not enough, so we needed some other resource. Okay, glucose need to be synthesized in the body from non-carbohydrate sources. Okay, carbohydrate sources are glycogen. Non-carbohydrate means other than carbohydrates. Okay, so gluconeogenesis, that's what we call it as gluconeogenesis. The major site of gluconeogenesis is liver, okay, with a small amount also taking place in kidney. So these are the two major places where 99% of gluconeogenesis happens. But scientists found that there is also a possibility that gluconeogenesis takes place in the brain, skeletal muscle and heart, but to a minuscule percentage. Gluconeogenesis uses many of the same reactions as glycolysis in reverse. Okay, I'm just giving you the outline here. Glycolysis and gluconeogenesis appear to be connected to each other in the reverse order. However, we have three sites where hexokinase or glucokinase, that is one step, phosphofructokinase and pyruvate kinase. So these are the three reactions we also have seen in the earlier lectures while discussing about the thermodynamics of glycolysis. We have seen these are the three reactions where there is so much of delta G value difference is there, minus value. That's the reason why these reactions are considered as almost irreversible. Almost irreversible. So except these three, the remaining reactions are almost reversible. So that's the reason why they are used as such. So in gluconeogenesis, these three steps are done by three separate enzymes. Gluconeogenesis pathway usually converts pyruvate into glucose. Okay, pyruvate into glucose. So here what happens is, from the metabolites that are obtained from non-carbohydrate resources, so they are usually translated or converted into pyruvic acid, and from pyruvic acid usually gluconeogenesis pathway is initiated. We do have other inputs that can be given to gluconeogenesis pathway that we will see in the coming slides. Okay, non-carbohydrate precursors of glucose are first converted into pyruvate by one or the other way, then these are later converted into oxaloacetate and dihydroxyacetone phosphate. Lactate is readily converted into pyruvate by action of lactate dehydrogenase enzyme. Okay, because lactate is synthesized in the skeletal muscles during anaerobic metabolism. Okay, glycolysis only, anaerobic environment, pyruvate is converted into lactate. So that can be reconverted into pyruvic acid with the help of lactate dehydrogenase enzyme. Glycerol is obtained from where? From lipids. Okay, if you take lipids, they are triglycerides. Triglycerides means what? Glycerol is esterified onto esterified with three fatty acids. Okay, so in that case, glycerol is released in the fatty acid metabolism. So this glycerol is released in the fatty acid metabolism. So this will be converted to glyceraldehyde. Okay, glyceraldehyde. So this we will see in the coming slides. So this is the way how lipids also can contribute to gluconeogenesis. But the only thing that we need to remember over here is, fats cannot be converted to glucose because acetyl coenzyme A cannot be incorporated into gluconeogenesis pathway. We don't have that pathway, but plants, microbes, they have the pathway. We call it as glyoxal pathway, where acetyl coenzyme A can be incorporated into carbohydrate biosynthesis or glucose biosynthesis. Okay, and here amino acids derived from proteins in the diet and during starvation from the breakdown of proteins in the skeletal muscle, okay, the amino acids will get metabolized, means oxidative deamination happens, and then the fragments are incorporated into gluconeogenesis pathway. Okay, so this is the way how we can make use of our own amino acids present in skeletal muscles during starvation for the biosynthesis of glucose. So here you can see glycerol can be converted to glycerol phosphate and then dihydroxyacetone phosphate. This dihydroxyacetone phosphate, with the help of triose isomerase, it can be converted to glyceraldehyde monophosphate, 3-phosphate, and then from there you can join dihydroxyacetone phosphate and glyceraldehyde phosphate via aldolase enzyme. So that will join them together to give you fructose 1,6-biphosphate. Okay, so that is the way how lipids can contribute to gluconeogenesis. Friends, this is what is glycolysis. You have seen this one earlier, but I am again showing you just to let you know that the processes, where exactly the processes will alter. So here we are starting from glucose and ending with pyruvic acid, or in case of anaerobic metabolism, lactate. Okay, now our objective is to go from here to here. Okay, how? Because in the thermodynamics of glycolysis, okay, so we know that we have studied this one. Okay, hexokinase activity, where approximately minus 23 kilojoules of energy delta G value is there. So that's the reason why glucose to glucose 6-phosphate conversion is a committed step. Okay, in glycolysis, if glucose is converted to glucose 6-phosphate, it will usually end up as pyruvate. So that's the reason why we consider hexokinase activity as irreversible. The next one is here, phosphofructokinase, which adds one phosphate to fructose 6-phosphate, so that fructose 1,6-diphosphate is obtained. Here also, this is also a very important reaction, but so much of minus delta G value is there. And then the next one is this one, pyruvate kinase. This is also another very important enzyme where so much of delta G value is there. So that's the reason why these are the three sites where we need to alter the pathways, so thereby we can convert pyruvic acid to glucose. So in gluconeogenesis, basically these are the three places where you will find different enzymes. All the remaining enzymes almost remain the same. Now let's see, gluconeogenesis is, it appears to be reverse of glycolysis, but gluconeogenesis is not exactly a reversal of glycolysis. Several reactions must differ because the equilibrium of glycolysis lies far on the side of pyruvate formation, because approximately minus 70 kilojoules of energy will be there, delta G value will be there altogether. So that's a huge number. And in this process we are getting, we are extracting energy from glucose, so that net 2 ATPs are obtained. Okay, that's the reason why glycolysis always, you know, it moves towards pyruvate formation. But here the actual delta G value from formation of pyruvate from glucose is about minus 20 kilocalorie, otherwise minus 80 kilojoules under typical cellular conditions. Glucose for plus ATP, so like in case of hexokinase, here minus 33 kilojoules of energy is there. This is one major contributor. The second contributor is fructose 6-phosphate to fructose 1,6-biphosphate, where 1 ATP is consumed. And then we have the third one, where phosphoenol pyruvate upon substrate level phosphorylation happens over here. It transfers energy to ADP, so that you will get pyruvate and ATP. Here I just would like to mention one thing, like in case while studying high energy compounds, we have seen this one, phosphoenol pyruvate is a high energy compound with 45 kilojoules of energy. Okay, so that's the reason why it always would like to react with ADP to provide ATP. This is a very important reaction, though the delta G value is relatively less than the remaining two, but phosphoenyl pyruvate is not a very stable molecule. Okay, so that's the reason why the reaction always go in this direction, wish to go in this direction. So in these three reactions, exact reversal is not possible, not reversible. Okay, so that's the reason why we need to have alternate pathways. To summarize whatever I told you till now, so this is the figure where you can clearly see that the kind of delta G values that you will observe at intermittent steps in glycolysis. Okay, so where pyruvate the last step as well as in the beginning, you can see big numbers. Okay, -33.9 kilojoules in case of hexokinase activity, and then in the fructose 1,6-bisphosphate synthesis, energy gap of -18.9 kilocalories kilojoules is there, and in substrate level phosphorylation that is happening at the last step, you are getting -23.0 kilojoules of energy. So in case of gluconeogenesis, in these steps, the enzymes that we have, they actually utilize energy. So thereby the net change in case of glycolysis is -75 kilojoules, whereas in gluconeogenesis the net change is -36.3 kilojoules. That means we are spending a lot of energy in biosynthesis of glucose. Let's see the step-by-step process of gluconeogenesis. A little bit of gluconeogenesis happens in the cytosol, a little bit happens in the mitochondria, but mitochondria only two steps happen in mitochondria. Let's see one by one. Let's start from lactate. Okay, so lactate forms in the skeletal muscle during anaerobic metabolism. The lactate can be converted to pyruvate by using lactate dehydrogenase enzyme. Pyruvate can also be derived from amino acids and other alternating resources. So the pyruvate has to now enter into mitochondria. As you all knew, mitochondria is like a sealed battery. Okay, so the membranes are virtually impermeable, but the outer membrane is slightly permeable. So thereby you can find some kind of absorption that is possible from this membrane. And then internal membrane contains pyruvate translocase, so that pyruvate can be transported into mitochondrial interiors. In mitochondria, pyruvate reacts with carbon dioxide, so that an enzyme, we call it as pyruvate carboxylase, that is the enzyme which transfers carbon dioxide onto pyruvate. So thereby we are biosynthesizing here oxaloacetate. So oxaloacetate is, pyruvate is CH3 C double bond O COOH. Okay, oxaloacetate means from here you are going to add one more carboxylic acid. This is like that. Okay, so here we are actually adding one carbon dioxide to the molecule. So similar kind of reaction you can see in case of urea cycle, where carbamoyl unit is synthesized, where it by capturing ammonia with, so we'll have enzyme, yes, carbamoyl phosphate, sorry, OP will be there. Activated carbon dioxide is synthesized in the beginning. This will react with ammonia so that carbamoyl NH2 C double bond O OP is going to be synthesized. So this will actually initiate the urea cycle. Here one carboxylase enzyme will be there. Here another carboxylase enzyme will be there. Okay, they appear like the same, but here in the carbon dioxide activation, 2 moles of ATP are going to be consumed. So here I am representing that, so that pyruvate can be converted to oxaloacetate. Now this oxaloacetate is reduced by malate dehydrogenase enzyme to give us malate molecule. This is almost like reversal of citric acid cycle. Okay, so now mallet can be transported outside by using mallet transporters. Mallet that is released into the cytosol now enters into the gluconeogenesis pathway. Now mallet again is oxidized, reoxidized to oxaloacetate. So by using NADH, so what is happening here? Reversal is happening. So inside, reduction is happening. Here, oxidation is happening. So what is it that we have? C double bond O, COOH, CH2, COOH. Okay, so this is oxaloacetate. So this oxaloacetate will then lose 1 mole of carbon dioxide. This you can see because alpha keto carboxylic acids, and on the other day we had discussed about this one. Alpha keto carboxylic acids are high energy compounds, because here this carbon has carbon positive delta positive value, here also we have delta positive value, so that's the reason why there is very low entropy between these two bonds. High energy built up will be there, so that helps in the dissociation of this bond and then synthesis of phosphoenolpyruvate. Then phosphoenolpyruvate will be converted to glycerate, because from here onwards glycolysis enzymes will come into the picture. So this 2 phosphoglycerate will be converted to 3 phosphoglycerate, 3 phosphoglycerate to 1,3 biphosphoglycerate, 1,3 biphosphoglycerate to glycerol 3 phosphate. Up to this one you will not find any difference. So this glycerol 3 phosphate can be converted to dihydroxyacetone phosphate. It is a reversible process. Further, the glycerol that is obtained from fixed oils or otherwise lipid metabolism can also be incorporated into glycerol 3 phosphate, this pathway. And glycerol 3 phosphate and dihydroxyacetone phosphate together with the help of aldolase enzyme produce fructose 1,6 biphosphate. This fructose 1,6 biphosphate has to be converted to fructose 6 phosphate, because here it has to lose one inorganic phosphate, and losing inorganic phosphate is a high energy situation. And if you see the reaction kinetics that is happening inside the cytosol, the fructose 1,6 actually here phosphofructokinase will be there in glucokinase glycolysis, where that the reaction kinetics are much towards fructose 1,6 biphosphate and not towards fructose 6 biphosphate. That's the reason why we need here a new enzyme. That's what we call it as fructose 1,6 biphosphatase. Phosphatases are the enzymes which breaks up the phosphoric acid ester bond, so that inorganic phosphate is released into the reaction medium. Then fructose 6 phosphate will be converted to glucose 6 phosphate by using the same enzyme, that is phosphoglucomutase, same enzyme as glycolysis. Now this glucose 6 phosphate has to be converted to glucose. This is actually a very big bottleneck as far as gluconeogenesis is concerned. But because in gluconeogenesis, what is our objective? Our objective is to see that blood glucose level is maintained. It is not the glucose 6 phosphate synthesis. Okay, our objective is not glycolysis. Glycolysis happens in tissues, in different tissues. Okay, but here our objective is to supply glucose. Hence, we have a separate enzyme, we call it as glucose 6 phosphatase, which breaks down inorganic phosphate so that glucose is produced. Okay, so friends, this is the way how gluconeogenesis happens in our body. So here pyruvate carboxylase, and then phosphoenol pyruvate carboxykinase, and then glucose 6 phosphatase, fructose 1,6 biphosphatase, they actually control rate of reaction as far as gluconeogenesis is concerned. They are unique to the gluconeogenesis pathway. Here the glucose 6 phosphate, how actually it is released into the cytosol. So here two compartment model works here, where the glucose, that is glucose 6 phosphate that is biosynthesized, will enter into endoplasmic reticulum. okay, lumen of endoplasmic reticulum, where we have this enzyme glucose 6 phosphatase. Okay, glucose 6 phosphatase enzyme will be there in this compartment. It is not released into the cytosol or in any other way, because it is localized only over here. So that's the reason why it can degrade glucose 6 phosphate to glucose. So thereby glucose and inorganic phosphate both will be released through glucose transporter mechanisms. So this glucose that we have in the endoplasmic reticulum, gap over here, so that will cross, because this is nothing but blood, you can say, or cytosol. And then from here, the plasma membrane is crossed because GLUT2 transporter is there, so that enters into your cytosol. Let's say if glucose 6 phosphatase is released into regular cytosol, what will happen? The glycolysis pathway cannot happen. Glycolysis will not happen because the glucose 6 phosphate that is produced by hexokinase will be degraded by glucose 6 phosphatase enzyme. So thereby you will not get any kind of energy. No energy will come. So it will become illogical. So that's the reason why glucose 6 phosphatase enzyme, if it is compartmentalized, then only we can leverage energy from these pathways. In summary, we can see glycolysis and gluconeogenesis show reciprocal controls to prevent futile cycles. 6 NADH and 3 ATPs are needed for biosynthesis of 1 glucose unit from pyruvate. So that means gluconeogenesis is not a high energy producing pathway. Its main objective is to supply glucose for the survival of a tissue. But here we can find a energy gap of approximately 30 kilojoules of energy will be wasted in this pathway when you compare it with glycolysis. Gluconeogenesis pathway gets inputs from various resources, including fatty acids and amino acids. If you take into consideration amino acids, you can see alanine, cysteine, glycine, serine, threonine, all of them, they can provide pyruvic acid. Isoleucine can provide acetyl coenzyme A, which will go into citrate cycle. But here, citrate cycle also indirectly supports gluconeogenesis, because oxaloacetate and malate are inputs for gluconeogenesis. So in one or the other way, indirectly acetyl coenzyme A that is incorporated into citrate cycle can also be utilized for the gluconeogenesis in this way, by providing malate or otherwise oxaloacetate to this pathway. Asparaginase and aspartate provides oxaloacetate, tyrosine phenylalanine provides fumarate, and then arginine, histidine, proline, glutamine, they indirectly provides glutamate. From glutamate, alpha-ketoglutarate will be obtained. The remaining amino acids like isoleucine, valine, etc., they will give us succinic acid. So that they are giving so many inputs into tricarboxylate cycle. So that's why it can reflect in the ease with which we can abstract malate and oxaloacetate from citric acid cycle. So as we discussed in the earlier classes while discussing about the citric acid cycle, so citric acid cycle indirectly supports gluconeogenesis in this way. Okay. So this is the way how gluconeogenesis helps our system maintain blood glucose level. I thank all of you for your patient listening. If you have any doubts in the entire process of glycolysis, please let me know through the comments section. Okay, you can post your comment so that I'll try to clarify your doubts. I thank you for your active participation in the today's lecture, and I'll meet you again in another very interesting lecture soon. Thank you.